Welcome to the program. I'm Mark Imperial. This segment's being brought to you by BooksGrowBusiness.com. It's the place where busy professionals get their books done and published to educate their consumers, to grow their practices, and to leave a legacy. I'm doing a series of spotlights on remarkable advisors across the country. And joining me on this segment is John Nowicki. He's the president of LCM Capital Management. John, welcome to the program.
Great. Thanks for having me, Mark. Enjoy it. Look forward to it.
John, tell us a little bit about LCM Capital Management, and specifically, who are the types of folks that you help?
So my partner and I started the firm, Mark, 22 years ago. And my partner and I have also been in the business for 34 years. And the reason we started LCM Capital Management was purely because of the fact that we saw what was happening in the industry on the retail brokerage side, where it was more about the firm making money and not the client making money. So what LCM stands for is low cost management. And our belief is really simple. People are overcharged to have their money managed. And we want to educate the clients as to the costs, the fees, the risks that are involved, and simplify the business. And so our market is really everybody, but our typical client falls in the $10 million and below. Because you know what we have typically seen over the years is a client may have two or three different relationships and some money spread out thinking they're diversified. But what ends up happening is when we sit down with them and show them exactly what they own, it turns out they own all the same things just in different suits, for lack of better words. So that's really why we're here and why we started the company is to really educate and show people what really happens below the surface.
For those folks with 10 million in assets and below, do they have a common challenge? Like, obviously, the cost that you identified is one of the biggest challenges that people have. But what is their biggest challenge that those folks face?
I would say the biggest challenge they face is under diversification. Would be the biggest challenge. And what I mean by that is that typically people end up chasing performance and chasing what's worked. And that's on my business, right? That's on my industry. My industry loves to just create things that are working and have the money flow into that. Well, eventually what ends up happening is whatever was working doesn't work. And so that's the biggest issue is you know, being diversified and staying the course and not chasing whatever seems to be the hot subject or asset class of the day.
Gotcha. As we speak today, we're coming out of this pandemic. We're not quite out of the woods yet. But what have you found this pandemic has done to your particular industry and the folks that you serve? Has it opened up any eyes, changed outlook? What was the effect?
Yeah, it's a great question. A dose of reality is really what it would be. I think from our perspective, you know, how we manage our clients' money is low turnover, not trying to time the market. And I go back to March of 2020 when the world was ending, right? Everyone was indoors, we're washing our vegetables. I mean, it was bad. But we put out a piece talking about if you stay the course and stay invested in the stock market and not try and time it, the results are exponentially better than someone who tries to time it. My numbers are going to be off slightly, Mark, but you know, relatively speaking, from 2000 to 2019, if you missed the best 20 trading days out of those days, which is less than 0.5% of those days, your rate of return went from 7% to factually nothing. Which is crazy, right? No one's going to be able to predict those days. So that was one of the things that I think people, especially our clients, learned. The other was, you know, to have some cash and obviously be ready for that rainy day. Obviously, cash doesn't make a lot of money today, but at the end of the day, you're talking about people were scared and they were hunkered down and they were worried. Well, cash sometimes comes in very handy, but again, having that diversification and cash being an asset class, just to make sure you take a little of the edge off. And the other thing that I would say is people realized what they were spending, right? I mean, doing a monthly budget. Most people we talk to, no matter where they fall in a wealth category, Mark, have no idea what they spend monthly. this was a dose of reality for people to say, okay, we're hunkered down. What are we spending money on? What are we not spending money on? And it turns out that people realized they were spending way more money on things they didn't need. And the end result is now the savings rates, right, are the highest levels they've been. And a lot of that is due to the fact that they weren't spending money and they realized they didn't need to spend money, which then creates the opportunity to save more money, which obviously is the goal for everybody to reach that happy retirement, because that's an important factor of it.
Eye-opening for sure. And people clearly learn more from, you know, bad circumstances than good in some cases. You know, speaking of that, you know, getting started at all and getting diversified, having cash, having a plan. A lot of people like to kind of push this, stick their head in the sand, kind of push it till tomorrow. And I'd imagine this has been sort of a wake-up call. What other kind of like myths or misconceptions are holding people back from getting properly prepared or sabotaging their success?
I would say simple, the fact that they don't have enough money, right? I mean, look, at our industry is predicated and focused on the wealthy people. But the problem is, it's all relative, right? I mean, $10,000 to one person is a lot of money. To another, it may not. And so that's kind of where our business fits in. I mean, because we don't have a minimum investment, right? So the people think, I don't have enough money, I can't afford to hire somebody. That's hogwash. You know, you can do it. You can be diversified. You don't need a lot of money to be diversified. There are ETFs, exchange traded index funds, that we use as part of our portfolio allocation. Gives you instant diversification. So the biggest myth is I think people just think they don't have enough money, and so they don't invest it, or they don't try and hire someone to do it. And the reality of it is they can hire someone to do it, and it can be done properly.
Every little bit counts, it sounds like.
Yes, no question about it.
So with that myth or misconception, when you start working with people, have you seen like a big common glaring mistake or pitfall that you see people doing because of some misinformation they've had? What are some of the big, you know, mistakes or pitfalls that you've seen?
Two things. I would say spending an exorbitant amount of money, way more than they ever imagined that they were spending to have their money managed, right? So one of the things that we do is show them exactly what it's costing, you know, within a parameter, a ballpark, to saying, hey, here's what you're paying for X, here's what you're paying for Y, let's put this all together, and then the light goes on. And then the other one is the diversification issue that I mentioned previously. People are just under diversified because, again, the mutual fund industry, and we don't own mutual funds, we hate them. They were created to make money for the house, right? There was a joke in the industry, you want to make a lot of money in our industry, start a mutual fund. So we don't like them. And the reason that is because they end up focusing in on particular areas and sectors, and the money gets flown into these things. And then clients don't have control of it. They don't have control of the tax distributions that are in there. They don't have control of the fees that are in there. And so those are the things that we explain to people and really get down to the basics. Because again, it's a very simple industry, but my industry wants to make it more complicated, because then if it's more complicated, then they can charge you more money for that complication. And it doesn't need to be that way.
Very interesting insight for sure. John, what inspired you to get started in this industry and help folks? How'd you get started?
Well, I started in 1987, in September of 87, right before the crash, right? So that was my wake up call. I like to tell people I didn't have any of my clients invested in the stock market in the crash of 87. And it's a true statement, just because I didn't have any clients. So that was definitely one of the differences. But in getting involved in it, I mean, just helping people, right? I mean, look, I have a personal story that I tell everybody. I mean, we started this business, my partner and I had four kids and took out a second mortgage. My wife wasn't working. I went to the bank for a third mortgage. And my banker said, you know, Johnny, sorry, there's nothing here. So I was at that other side. And that's when I came to the realization, that old God moment of, I have to figure out what it costs me every single month to have my money managed. I need to know how much money I need to save, what I can do for college. I mean, I had that. So when when we sit down with clients, I mean, I'm a living, breathing example of that person who, you know, didn't come from that side of the tracks. My father worked three jobs. So, you know, I know what people are going through. And so I do that with my children when they've graduated from college. I sit down with them and say, let's talk 401k, let's talk investing. And to a 23-year-old, you say, you got to start putting $300 a month away. And they're like, $300 a month? I mean, that's a lot of money. Well, then put $300 a month in over the next 30 years, run it at 5% and tell me what you think. And at the age of 55, they have more money than I'll probably ever have in my entire life. So that's what made me get involved in this, is just the fact of educating the people to what is important, because as you well know, most people are very for retirement financially. And you alluded to it earlier, you know, we'll meet with clients and be like, all right, let's go. Let's do some retirement planning. I'm like, okay, what do you got? And they're like, no, I'm gonna start now. And I realize that that's how a lot of people are. But the frightening thing is that Social Security, the average Social Security, I think, is $1,800 a month. And I don't know very many people who can survive on that. Yet the statistics point out that 40% of people believe that Social Security will be their predominant income during retirement. So helping people and educating them from the beginning is really what made me got into this. And that's the fun part about it, Mark, is the planning and all of that stuff, because it's really nice to see that light go on for people.
And that's really eye-opening for folks, and for you to educate them and let them know the earlier, the better, because you got time on your side.
Absolutely.
John,
Absolutely.
Before I ask you my last question, for folks that are looking for an advisor who've had their head in the sand, perhaps, what should they look for in an advisor when they're meeting them and interviewing them and deciding who to work with?
Absolutely. Well, the first thing I would say is ask them if they're a fiduciary, right? That's a word in my industry that's starting to pick up some steam. And that just means, and that's what we are, is a fiduciary. And that means we are legally obligated to put the client's interest ahead of ours. So that would be the first question that I would ask anybody that you're talking to. Are you a fiduciary? Once that box is checked, then you know there's an obligation for you to be first and not mine. Secondly, I would ask them, what are the costs that you charge to have my money managed? You know, and are you obligated to use a particular or a family of funds or I hate to use the word product, but that's really what ends up happening at the end of the day, is can you use any investment that exists, or are you beholden to a particular set or family of investments? So those would be a couple of the key questions that I would ask anybody. And obviously starting off number one, being a fiduciary, and how you would know that is then you would just ask them for their ADV or their and their CRS. Those are two documents that we are legally required to have, and we have to give to every prospective client. If they don't have those, Mark, then you know right away, even though their business card may say advisor, they're not a fiduciary. And that's a big, big selling point from our perspective.
Wow, great information. I appreciate that. So John, for folks listening now that would love to meet with you and learn more, how do they find you?
Well, they can reach us at lcmcapital.com is our website. And our email is lcm@lcmcapital.com. That's Larry Charlie Mary CAPITAL.com, or the good old fashioned way of calling. You know, they can call us at 312-705-3013. And either way, any of those ways will reach us, and we'd be happy to sit down with you. And Mark, I should tell you that, you know, we don't charge to sit down with people. You know, you hire us to do something that comes with the whole process. So we're going to sit down and rip through everything. And as we tell people, you may not like the answers we're going to give you, but they're going to be honest answers, and you're going to need and want to be educated on it because it's important.
John, this has been terrific. I really appreciate you taking the time and sharing with my audience today. I wish you continued success for you, for LCM Capital Management, and for all of your clients.
Mark, thanks very much for the invitation. I enjoyed it and look forward to obviously catching up with you in the near future.
That was John Nowicki. He's the president of LCM Capital Management. And this segment's been brought to you by BooksGrowBusiness.com. It's the place where busy professionals get their books done and published to educate their consumers, grow their practices, and to leave a legacy. That's all for now. I'm Mark Imperial, and thanks for joining me.